lift up the name of Jesus and lift up his name. There is healing, there is power in his name this morning. So lucky
honor and praise belong unto you, Lord. And therefore we bless you today and we honor you and we thank you for what you're about to do. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. Well, we want to welcome you this morning in the wonderful name of Jesus and our online viewers. We thank God for the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. The Apostle Paul, writing into the New Testament in Romans chapter 1, verse number 16, he says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jews and also to the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, for it is written, the just shall live by faith. So we welcome you to our program this morning, and I pray that God will just richly bless you as I start a series, a five-part series on walking in the supernatural power of Jesus, or the power of God. Now, before we even consider walking in the supernatural power of Jesus, we need a revelation of the supernatural God. There are certain necessary criteria that will bring us to this revelation. That is, number one, a hunger for God, and number two, sacrifice. We find that a lot of people have physical hunger, but they need to develop a spiritual hunger for God. A lot of people make sacrifices in the natural realm and in terms of their profession, in terms of their career, in terms of their business, but they need to apply the same kind of passion and make the sacrifices towards spiritual things so that God can bring them to the understanding of the supernatural. People hunger to perform in a circular world. By that I mean they have passion, they have desire and zeal to complete tasks where duty bounds. Yet when it comes to spiritual hunger, passion, desire, and zeal, they lack sorely. Hunger is to have a strong and a powerful desire for, a longing and a yearning that cannot be broken or cannot even be denied. When you lose the consciousness of the Holy Spirit in your life, you lose your hunger. When the consciousness of the Holy Spirit operating in your life diminishes because of a lack of concentration on Him and applying the Word of God, you will find your life slowly losing a zeal for God, a passion for God, and a desire for God. The God of the believer is the God of miracles and the supernatural. Christianity cannot be relevant if it does not have the supernatural and the miraculous. What makes the Christian life more than just any other religion or philosophy? The miracle power of Jesus working in the life of a believer. This makes us credible. That this makes us the people of God upon the earth. The Lord Jesus Christ, when he entered into the earth and during his incarnation and period of time that he was here for 33 and a half years, his ministry was characterized by signs, wonders, and miracles. This is the proof that Jesus lives, that he is not just a good teacher and a wise guru. Jesus is more than all that. Jesus is the Son of the living God. Now, I want to share a couple of important points with you today and why we need to walk in the supernatural. One, you will discover that the cross is the only source of the supernatural. Number two, you will learn how to live a life of faith in the midst of a dangerous and uncertain world. You will still have victory. Number three, you will learn how to walk in the anointing and transition from the anointing into the glory of God. Number four, you will learn how to receive your miracle and what to do so God can use you to perform miracles and you can be a blessing to in the lives of people. Now, Jesus, the Jesus that we serve, is a Jesus of miracles. He's a healing, working Jesus. Jesus said, "The works that I do, you shall do. And greater works than these shall you also do." You will receive miracles in your life, financial deliverances, breakthroughs in your mind and your emotions when you begin to enter into the supernatural realm and walk in the supernatural realm. God will impart revelation to you activation and transformation to you so that you can impart to others. Now in Mark 16:15, when Jesus was upon the earth and he's talking to his disciples before, as he gives them the great commission, he said to them, go into all the world and preach the gospel. But before he said that, this is what he said: these signs shall follow them who shall lay hands upon the sick and they shall recover. And notice the word of God says, and they went everywhere preaching the gospel with signs, wonders and miracles, because Jesus was accompanying them through the power of the Holy Spirit. We cannot fathom God through our finite imaginations. Neither can we understand God through intelligence. And his great power and his great love cannot be fathomed through intelligence. God can only be known through revelation. So the first aspect of walking in the supernatural is walking in the revelation of God. And before I come to that, I want to lay a little foundation here for you to understand. God's intention was never for us, for him to be a mystery to us. But his intention was for us to know him intimately and know him passionately as he begins to walk with us and strengthen us. And we will be able to understand his attributes, his strengths, and his virtues. Now to reveal himself as the supernatural and all-powerful God, he sent us his Holy Spirit. There is no other means that we can know God but through the revelation that he reveals through the Holy Spirit. God cannot be defined, because no person has the mental ability and who can describe this infinite God and this eternal God. Now, who is God? God is spiritual. God is eternal. God is immutable, a mutable being with supernatural attributes and abilities. He dwells in the dimensions of eternity and in the spirit realm or spiritual realm, and manifests in visible forms in the natural dimension. The word of God says in the book of Isaiah 57:15, thus says the lofty one who inhabits eternity. He inhabits eternity, the one who's lifted high. The only way you can know God is through revelation. Well, now, what is revelation, you may ask? The Greek word revelation is apokalypsis, which means laying bare, making naked, a disclosure of truth, instruction concerning things before unknown, things that were unknown to us. But it's revealed to us. God is laying it bare to us. He's making it naked to us. He's disclosing the truth to us so that we can walk in the power of this truth as he exposes this truth to us. That is revelation. This is how we understand the spiritual realm. It's unknown to us, but revealed through the Holy Spirit to us. Revelation is the knowledge of God revealed to our spirits and is received by spiritually seeing, spiritually hearing, and spiritually perceiving. This process is referred to as spiritual perception. Perception is the way we see things. Now, there's two aspects of perception, or to know things. The first is the word ginosko, is learning to know. Then we have the word, well, oida really is learning to know, and ginosko is to know perfectly well. As we learn to know, as we keep on doing the word of God, God begins to reveal and begins to expose the truth and makes it, well, he lays it bare before us and exposes the truth to us, that we begin to walk in the revelation of the truth that sets us free. Revelation allows you to suddenly understand something without the aid of your senses or your emotions. This knowledge and understanding is only given by the Holy Spirit. In Matthew chapter 16, and we're going to read from verse number 13, when Jesus comes to Caesarea Philippi. Now, Caesarea Philippi is one of the 10 Decapolis states on the outskirts of Israel. It's amazing that Jesus is speaking to his disciples concerning his divinity and his deity outside Israel. And he comes to Caesarea Philippi, and the word of God says, when Jesus came into the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? Notice he said, not the Son of God, the Son of Man am. So they said, some say John the Baptist, some Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. And he said to them, the disciples, but who do you say that I am? Then Simon Peter answered and said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus answered and said to him, blessed, empowered are you to prosper, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. A very powerful scripture here in verse number 17. And the verse says, he says, Jesus says to Peter, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. You cannot know Jesus and know God through knowledge. You only can know him through revelation. So when Peter said to Jesus, Jesus, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God, Jesus immediately replies, flesh and blood has not revealed this unto you. So natural senses and our sensory mechanisms cannot fathom God, the Spirit of God, and the Holy Spirit. We can only understand him through revelation. And therefore he says that he goes on to say, and I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. You need to first have a revelation of who Jesus is. Revelation and the truth of him being the Son of the living God. That's when you will find your life begin to grow to a greater level, and the expose of the supernatural will manifest in your life. Now, to receive revelation from God is to see as he sees, to hear as he hears, and to perceive as he perceives. It is the mind of God revealed to mankind so he can exercise dominion in time, space, and matter. It's not learned, it's revealed. You go to college, we go to school for 12 to 14 years, and then go to tertiary education, and then we pursue a career or a profession. It takes us years of learning, but those are learned abilities. In fact, most times, 90% of the time, that is really not your gift. That is just a learned ability. But learning about God or serving God and understanding God and understanding the gift that God has put on the inside of you cannot be learned. It is revealed. And when it's revealed, it's enhanced by other kind of knowledge that we have in terms of adding to that to bring us to our destiny and fulfillment of our purpose. In Western culture, intellectual formation has overtaken divine revelation, pushing the latter into second place status. We are trained to reject anything and everything that does not make sense or cannot be explained in human understanding. Now the word of God says in the book of Romans chapter 12 and verse 2, he says, be not conformed to this world. Do not let this natural world squeeze you into its mold, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. We will never be able to understand God until we first have a transformed heart, a renewed mind, and then we allow the Holy Spirit to reveal to us who he really is for us to walk in the supernatural and have signs, wonders, and miracles in our lives daily. Mankind criticizes everything he cannot create and understand. In the absence of progressive divine revelation, people turn to formal, natural, intellectual education, much of which serves to discredit faith. Intellectual knowledge has its rightful place in society, but it is a poor substitute for spiritual revelation and knowledge. And that's the reason why people have so much of knowledge, intelligentsia, education in the world, but cannot solve the world problems. We can only do so with the revelation of who God is, who Jesus is, and walking in the supernatural. Who is the source of revealed knowledge? The Holy Spirit. He gives us access to God's revealed wisdom and his revelation. The Holy Spirit hears what he said in heaven, and then he repeats it to us upon the earth so that we can function in the power of the supernatural. We cannot know God without the help of the Holy Spirit. Jesus' ministry was powerful upon the earth because he functioned with the Holy Spirit. There's many times you'd find in the Word of God, he separates himself into prayer because prayer gives you power. And he spent time with the Father. He spent time, the Holy Ghost began to manifest his power through Jesus' life. Therefore, he said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He's anointed me to live the supernatural. supernatural upon the earth and to manifest the power of God. Now, theologians may know a superior being exists, but it does not mean that they know God intimately. They have information about God and they've acquired the knowledge, but do they know Him intimately? You cannot know God without the Holy Spirit. Reasoning, mental processes, logical thinking cannot fathom God. It is too limited to fathom God. How did the Apostle Paul handle natural knowledge? Now we're going to turn to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 6 to 7 and notice what the Word of God says. However, we speak wisdom among those who are mature, yet not the wisdom of this age, nor of the rulers of this age who are coming to nothing. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the eyes for our glory. Notice the Word of God, we are mature. When we begin to flow in the Holy Spirit and we have this relationship with God's Holy Spirit that is given unto us, we are mature. We speak the wisdom among those who are mature, yet not the wisdom of this age. In fact, the Word of God says that the foolishness of God is wiser than the wisest man or the wisdom of man. And therefore, we find not that God is a fool at any time, but that's what the Apostle Paul is trying to explain, that God's wisdom supersedes the wisdom of the most intelligent people upon the earth put together. And then he goes on and says, not of the rulers of this age who are coming to nothing, but we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, hidden wisdom which was ordained before the ages for our glory. Then the Word of God says in the book of Colossians 1:25-27. Notice he says an interesting scripture here. Then the Apostle Paul writes in Colossians, I became a minister according to the stewardship from God, which was given to me for you to fulfill the Word of God, the mystery which has been hidden from ages and from generations, but now has been revealed to His saints. To them God willed to make known what are the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Christ living in the believer is the hope of glory. When Jesus comes to live inside of us and we accept Him as Lord and personal Savior, He comes with the Holy Spirit. Then we need the baptism of the Holy Spirit to cause the resurrection of life to take place. And through the baptism of the Holy Spirit, there is a rejuvenation. There is a resurrection of life. There is a life of God, the Zoe kind of life, that supersedes the natural life. And that's why we get the revelation through the Spirit of God operating in our lives. We search for revelation in this world when all the deep treasures and the wisdom of God is found in Christ. Do not let people begin to move you away from the genuine, perfect will of God. They can compliment you, applaud you, and tell you how good you are. But can I tell you something? Is it really what God wants you to do? I had to make a choice at some stage in my life to quit my job because I felt deep inside of me, God is saying this. It's you can have whatever you want to have in this life, and you can also have whatever God wants you to have. It's based on choice and decision. And quite often, too many people do not want to make the decision and begin to make the choice to follow God because they were too acclimatized to a geography, too acclimatized to working in a particular situation, and they feel that's the will of God. But to serve God and to work in God's domain and God's kingdom, sometimes it's not going to be comfortable, but it takes faith and it takes revelation. And as you begin to walk in that, God will bless you and prosper you. And the Word of God says that if you find your gift, you find your life, and God will prosper your life. Notice the Word of God says in 1 Corinthians chapter 2 verse 9 onwards, right to verse number 11, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor have it entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those who love Him. But God has revealed them to us through His Spirit. That's where revelation is, through the Holy Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things, the deep things of God. For what man knows the things of a man except the spirit of the man which is in him? Even so, no one knows the things of God except the Spirit of God. Our human minds cannot fathom everything that God wants to reveal to us and begins to expose to us in the realms of the supernatural. The only person that can assist us is the Holy Spirit, who knows all things of God and begins to expose the things of God, the mysteries of God to us. The only one who can reveal God is the Holy Spirit. The only way to know God and to relate to the supernatural is and into the invisible realm is by faith. It is not through knowledge, it is by faith. There are two realms that exist in this world. Number one, the natural realm. Number two, the supernatural realm. The natural laws are confined to the existence, our existence in the natural world. But the spiritual laws supersede the natural laws and bring us into the spiritual realm. We know them and have faith, and we need to know them and learn them and function in them. One of those principles that we will deal with next week is the principle of faith. We're now understanding revelation. Now we're going to move on to faith, and we put them together and other important principles. We will walk in the supernatural and be a blessing to the world. There are miracles in the supernatural realm that we draw into the natural. For example, when I was 21 years old, I remember very, very clearly, and I was praying. I was leading, it was a prayer meeting. And as I was, I had an altar call and praying over the people, there was a young girl that came forward with a deformed arm, dysfunctional from birth. And I put my hand on her arm, really on her palm, the palm of her hand. And I heard this voice say to me, "Not this place, a shoulder. Not a hand, but a shoulder. Not a hand, but a shoulder." It was really a faint voice speaking to me. And as I moved my hand to the shoulder, her hand just shot out and she was totally healed. You see, that's the voice of the Spirit. When we begin to enter through revelation and through the power of the Spirit into the supernatural, we hear another drumbeat. We hear another voice, the voice of God. And that's the reason why we need to move into the supernatural to enter into the dimensions of the supernatural so that we can enjoy God upon the earth. Every miracle of God is supernatural. Every healing is supernatural. And for us to experience the supernatural power of God, we need to have a divine, and we need to have a passionate relationship with the Holy Spirit. And that comes through hunger and the sacrifice that we would make. Now, the Word of God speaks about Joshua in Joshua chapter 2:10. He was fighting against the Gibeonites. Came a point in time in the battle that he could not win the battle unless he needed more hours. And the Word of God says in the book of Joshua chapter 10 and verse number 12 to 13, Joshua, as he fought, Joshua said, "In the sight of Israel, sun, stand still up over Gibeon, and moon, stay thou in the valley of Ajalon." So the sun stood still and the moon stopped till the people had revenged all their enemies. Now we know that the sun does not orbit. The sun stands still. It's the earth that orbits around the sun. But when Joshua spoke to the sun, God heard his voice, that God stopped the earth to orbit around the sun. And in one moment, God can stop things in your life. He can turn situations around for you to win every battle, because that's the God whom we serve. The miracle is that the earth stood still even though Joshua spoke to the sun. God can turn anything around. He understands your language. He understands even if you do not understand. But if you're passionate and if you want God to perform a miracle in your life, it's going to take a revelation and faith for you to enter into that realm. And God could listen to Joshua and stop the earth and its axis and give Joshua 24 hours to win the battle. Then God is a God of the supernatural. He will do anything for his children. God gave Abraham and Sarah a son in their old age. He enabled David to kill a giant called Goliath with a sling and a stone. He fed the widow of Zarephath and multiplied her oil and her flour. He separated the Red Sea with a man using his rod facing the waters, and the waters separated. Jesus, when he was upon the earth, straightened the back of a woman that was bent for 18 years. He raised Lazarus from the dead. He fed 5,000 men beside children and women with 5 loaves and 2 fish. He walked upon the water. He healed the lame. He opened the eyes of the blind. The mute began to speak. That's the Jesus that we serve. He is the supernatural Jesus. And if we are serving the supernatural Jesus, then there must be healings in our lives. There must be miracles in our lives and the supernatural power of God operating through our lives. Now, there are 5 enemies of the supernatural. Number one, ignorance. The Word of God says, "My people perish because they've gone into captivity because they have no knowledge." Revelation of who God is and how He functions. Number two, bad theology. Theology is the study of God through the mind and reason. When we study God with improper motivation, without inspiration, illumination, and revelation from the Holy Spirit, then theology becomes carnal knowledge. and we restrict and confine the movement of the supernatural in our lives. Number three, humanism. Humanism is the collection of philosophical ideas that elevate man to his highest position in terms of esteem or self-esteem. But it does not even reveal to you who God is in the supernatural. Number four, the spirit of Jezebel or witchcraft. It's a misuse of the mind, a victim's mentality, fears, feeling insecure about your life and all the other things. And so what happens is that that spirit operating in your life will restrict the power of the supernatural power of God. You see, witchcraft is very dangerous, and the usage of the mind the wrong way into negative emotions will not bring you into the supernatural. In Galatians 3:1, the Apostle Paul writes, "Oh foolish Galatians, who had bewitched you? Who had tricked you? Who had deluded you? Who had caused you to move away from the spirit and now you walk in the flesh?" So we ought not to walk in the spirit of Jezebel or witchcraft. And lastly, a carnal mind. The word of God says, "But to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace." And may I encourage you this morning that you can walk in the supernatural. God wants his believers. He wants his people to embrace the supernatural. That's the God we serve. The Jesus that walked upon the earth is supernatural. And I pray this morning that as you begin to have a revelation of God through the power of the Holy Spirit and allow him into your life as he exposes who he is, then God will reveal the supernatural to you in a dimension that you have never done before. You know, to have miracles in your life is easy. All you've got to do is walk with God. Have an intimate relationship with him. Walk in the revelation of the Holy Spirit. Just to encourage you, there was a woman that in the hospital suffering with COVID-19, and she was in hospital in the ICU unit for about almost 32 days. And something like 5 days ago, when she called me, I prayed over her and I said to her, "Within 48 hours, they will move you out of ICU in the general ward." The next morning, they moved her out of ICU into the general ward, and she's recovering and getting better as the days go by. I just want to encourage you, God is the God of the supernatural. He's the God of the miraculous. He's the God who does healings today. And as yesterday, as the Apostle Paul writes, and he says, "Yesterday, today, and forever, Jesus is the same." Come, let's pray the prayer of faith by the revelation of the Holy Spirit that you can walk in the supernatural today and every day of your life. Father, we come to you right now in the mighty name of Jesus. And for those, oh God, right now that need you in their life, we pray the prayer of faith. We ask, oh God, that they will open their heart to the Holy Spirit and they will have a revelation that you want to heal them. Lord, you want them to be well and you want them to have miracles and breakthroughs in their life. So we speak life into their bodies, life into their finances, life into their families, and whatever their desires are this morning, I speak breakthrough in the mighty name of Jesus. I pray God's blessing over